So then, Sairabhai, then Nirmala, and then I just went on, and the journey is, it's, I think it's not restricted to Karachi, but not to please stop me, because these women's sands make me talk a bit too much.
No, no, please go on.
Yeah, so that's how I turned to them, and Gary will... He has done fantastic translation. He's a very good translator. It was very difficult to translate an Abhang of 13th century to English. So he will tell us about how he dealt with it.
Can you unmute?
Hello. Sorry. I just like to say that, you know, these translations were work that we did together, Neela and I. I don't think one of us could have done them without the other. So it actually was teamwork in a certain way. She was the guide, my guide through this world, because it was not a world that I was very familiar with or very accustomed to. But as I write in the introduction, a complete accident of singing. A moment of epiphany actually happened in a local gym where the music system failed, and instead of the Dinchak music, I heard Neela Tai singing next to me, and she was singing singing Mungi Udali Akash. Now, the wonderful thing about an Indian classical musician singing something is that the line is not sung and it does not vanish after it is sung. You return to it. You travel with it, you go around it, you explore its nuances, you take a little, like an aerial tour around the line, and then you land on it again. And each time in your head, there is something else that is allowed to bloom. Each time that same image can take on a variant. So, Mungi Udali Akashi, Tine Gilile Suryanshi, when an ant flew into the sky and she swallowed the sun. What could that mean? Mm. At one level, it's obvious. It's just a complete... But are we talking about a solar eclipse here? Is this a moment of the solar eclipse? Is this a moment when Muktabai has actually witnessed something like that? Or is she a little girl playing in the mud and picks up a small ant gently, so gently, with her fingers, a black ant, and then he closes one eye and lifts the ant up so that it swallows the sun? Or is she talking about God? Is she talking about how it must feel to encounter God, like you swallow the sun? How does it begin? What is it? Where does it go? Well, and of course, like the journey of then, I said to Neela Tai, I said, you know, I'd love to read these. Are they available in translation? And she said, no, they haven't been translated. These women poets have not been translated. They have a few. I mean, Dilip Chitre has done a couple, Alun Kolatkar has done a couple, but in passing, en passant, you think a couple of in larger, there's been no, like the way Dilip Chitre took on Tukaram and made it a life mission and said at the end of his life that, you know, if he wanted to be remembered, he wanted to be remembered not as a poet, but as the translator of Tukaram. Nobody had done that for these women poets. So I said what I say to so many people. I said, you know, select 50 of what you think are the finest, most beautiful. She said 50 is impossible. I'll choose 100. So I said 100 is great. Let's start with that magic number, and we'll translate them together. And I've said this to so many people about, you know, Urdu poetry. I've said it about Hindi poetry. I've said it about Konkani poetry. I've said it to lots of people, Gujarati poetry, and nobody's ever come back. Life takes over and poetry tends to fade into the background. But I think Neela, these were an experience that was not just in the head, but it was in the body. When you sing, you embody a poem. It becomes throat and it becomes mind and it becomes heart and it becomes, and you bring everything to it. You bring your Guruji to it. He's in the room with you. And you bring the saint into the room with you. And you bring... You bring the word. How does this word fit and you bring the rag, and then you send the rag out, and you bring it back in again, and you work constantly with it. So these are not, this was not for her something that she would forget, and it was a challenge she took up. And about a couple of weeks later, she turned up at my house with 100 poems in hand, and we began what would take us the next 3 years or 4 years to do, to get right, you know, to bounce those poems again between us, for me to read them and to understand them and to understand who is a Muktabai. Because, you know, there is a general attitude towards bhakti, oh, these are God-mad people. They're just deeply in love with God and nothing else matters. They're all about love. But Muktabai is not only about love. Muktabai is heart, but she's also head. She's very clearly inside her head at some points. Muktabai's poetry is, she's the T.S. Eliot of the bunch. This is like the one you have to wrestle with. And of course, we have to start with her because, you know, Mungu Yudha.
And Nila Bhagavatatna, Tapan Bolte.
Yeah, so I think that was really the process. And I think now we should start with Nila, did you say that you were going to sing? What were you going to do first for us?
Neela? I thought of singing Nirmala's Abhang.
Yeah.
Nirmala is Chokhamera's sister.
Okay. So I'll read the English translation of the poem. It's called The Forest on Fire. All around me, the forest on fire. Yeah, I'll read the Marathi first. Yeah.
Yeah, I will read that. Sahu kade deva datala vanava kanaye kanava tujalagi sadale sandhi samsarache angi sudagi lagabagi maya apa kuma jau bal ala sine keshava lavalaji tujha vena maj kona got tu chi hit karta deva Nirmala म्हणून माय बापा
The forest on fire. All around me, the forest on fire. Don't my screams reach your ears? I'm trapped, Keshava. Run to me. Who else will? Who else can? Nirmala throws herself at your feet to pray. My protector, my Lord, don't turn me away.
Would you like to sing it now?
Yes.
Yeah, I will sing. And my tabla player Sandeep Pawar is sitting. He's not in the frame, but he's in the house sitting there, right hand side. So he's giving the rhythm for me.
And Neela ji. Hello.
Huh?
Neela ji, I think there is a problem with your audio. Is that is the audio clear for everyone? Because
voice is breaking, ma'am. Voice is not coming.
Yes.
Yeah, I found there was a breaking.
Okay.
There was some strangeness.
I think it's a problem. Everyone.
There's a lag. All right. Yes, let's hope it's.
Sahu kade deva datala vanava sahu kade deva datala बानाये कर्णवा बानाये कर्णवा बानाये कर्णवा तुझ लागी बानाये कर्णवा तुझ लागी बानाये कर्णवा तुझ लागी सापडले सांगे स्वराचे अंगी स्वराचे अंगी सोडवी लबगी सोडवी लबगी माया बापा सोडवी लबगी माया बापा सोडवी लबगी माया बापा चौकडे देवा ताटला वनवा कानये कणवा कानये कणवा तुझलागी कानये कणवा तुझलागी बहु मज उबग आला छे देवा बहु मज उबग आला असे देवा धाय केशवा धावे तू केशवा धावे तू केशवा लवलाहि धावे केशवा लवलाहि धावे तू केशवा लवलाहि मज तू जगीन मज कोण गण गोत तू जगीन मज कोण कोण गण गोत तुझी माझा Hey. परते न लोटिए माया बापा, 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 परते न लोटे माया बापा, परते न लोटे माया बापा, चहूकडे देवा दाटला वनवा, चहूकडे देवा दाटला वनवा, कान ये कनवा कानये कणवा उजला घंटी, कानये कणवा उजला घंटी, उजला
Can you hear me? Thank you, Neela. That was wonderful.
Is it audible enough?
Yeah, it's audible. Could you tell us a little about Nirmala? Why Nirmala in particular fascinates you so much?
I was really fascinated by Soira and Nirmala, who is her sister-in-law. And they love each other so much. They, like the sister-in-law and the Bhavi and the Nanand, they are not like that. They both are devotees of Vithala. They are worried about the brother because the brother is hit by the society because he, being a Mahat, he has no right to enter the temple, and he doesn't enter the temple, but Vithala comes to him, and all that people cannot understand, don't like, and they hate him and they hit him. So we thought that Soira and Nirmala get very close, and I thought that in poetry they are not at all worried about speaking in a sweet way. Nirmala, in another abhang, she says, Maja namachi avadi samsara kela deshodhari. Deshodhari is a very difficult word to use in a poem now, but she uses it. And it really fits very well. The way she has devoted, sacrificing everything she has devoted to Vithala, and the brother and the sister-in-law, and they all are such a lovely family. Her husband Banka and Soira's son Karma Mera, they're all very lovely people. So I think it is that love for each other is very fascinating, very beautiful. And that comes out because they are dearly devoted to one goal, which was Vithala. For us, Vithala may not be there, but we have a goal to achieve. And it is that goal that I can see in these abhangs. And therefore, I really could identify with them. Now that's what I've found about, especially this family of Soka and Nirmala and Soira and everyone.
Thank you. Jerry, would you like to add something or go to the...
No, I just, with this particular one, you know, the idea of the forest fire,
is
very striking as an image. And it actually tells you something about how the marg, the bhakti marg, is not for the weak of heart. Because, you know, I'm thinking of the great Christian saints who talk about the dark night of the soul. Because when God comes to you and there is that meltdown of gold and fire and lava, and you know, the ant has swallowed the sun, miracles are happening, when he abandons you, when he is not there, then you feel like the forest is on fire. Everything is burning. And then that leads me to that great Buddhist moment where, you know, he says, your house is burning.
Yes.
What are you doing sitting inside it? Why are you asking about the nature of fire? Walk, run out of the house. So here is a woman who is in the middle of a forest fire. Everything is burning. The world is in flames. Seems very familiar today also. It seems like we are burning. Everything is burning. All the time we've been burning. And bhakti, therefore, was not is not for love-drenched, love-mad women. It is for the brave of heart who can take that kind of fire, who can walk through the forest when it is in on fire.
Yeah.
That's nice.
Truly, truly. And that image, yeah, of course, anybody who is familiar with Buddhism, that connection is immediate. With the, you know, this idea of burning. And thank you so much.
Yeah.
So, which is the next poet you'd like to introduce us to?
Neelaji?
I was thinking of a poem written by Namdevad's wife, Rajai. Namdev was a dacoit and he must be bringing in a lot of money through the dacoity. But a time came when he saw a young child crying. The mother is crying and the mother says, what can I give you to eat? This Namdev has killed your father. I have nothing to feed you with. And Namdev does that, and that really turns him as a person. He becomes a devotee of Vithala, and a potter is his guru, Gora Kumar. No, it is Visoba Khechar. Khechar is a person who, I think he means the donkeys, and he is his guru. So they are not worried about the caste and the profession at all. So after that, after he became a devotee, life was different. There were no money, there was nothing to eat. And there were 14 people, as she mentions, to feed. Now, how do I feed 14 people when there is nothing for me to cook and feed them with? So this is what she says. And she is not bothered about any other thing except that she can't finish her job of the cooking and feeding others. Then she goes to Rukmini. She tells her that, look, tell your husband. He has driven my husband totally mad. So you must try and tell him and improve him a little. What is this? He's only dancing like a mad fellow. And he's so shameless. He doesn't give me anything. So all that, she is really like a woman who comes to the women's center with all her problems, and he tells and asks for the advice to those who are counseling. It's like a counseling session with Rajai, and that's what she speaks about. I really liked it because it's so dramatic and so true.
So,
shall I?
Should the Marathi first or the translation?
Marathi first.
I will read the Marathi first. Dona prahara ratra pahoni ekanta rajai vrittanta sange mate. That is Rukmini. Ahu rakuma bai vitvabasi sanga bhratarasi kaga vede kele ustra patra nahi khaya jevayasi nace ahar nisha nirlajjasa. Savada manushya aheti maje ghari hindati daro dari anna sathi. They have become like beggars. Bara marga tumi umajani sanga namayachi raja nave bali. I am not a good person. I am going to speak the truth. That's what she says.
Just talk to Namdev. In the second watch of the night, Rajai is alone and so is Rukmai. Bai, look at the state of my house and then intercede with your spouse. Why would he drive a devotee mad? 14 mouths and no grain to be had. Were I to get food, begging from door to door, in what would I serve it? My kitchen is no more. Call Rajai a harridan, call her a bore. I don't care, just talk to Namdev. Neelaji.
Yes, now I'm trying to put it in as dramatically as possible. Sandeep is there to accompany me. I must share something with you, that in most of the folk music in Maharashtra, the rag which is used is either Kalingda, which is very close to Bhairav, if you know Bhairav. Kalingda or Gauri. If you see Launi, they are in that rag. If you see Povadas, they are in the same rag. And also the Abhangs, many of them are in the same rag. Because it's easy to sing. And one is socialized into it, so it's not difficult to pick up the tune. And then you can sing and dance and enjoy yourself. That is the idea in using the same tune. I have used the same tune in this abhang, but I have made a little change because of the drama in this poem. Dona prahara ratra pahuni ekanta. Dona prahara ratra pahuni ekanta. Rajaye vrutanta. Rajaye vrutanta. Sange mate. Dona prahara ratra pahuni ekanta. Rajaye vrutanta. Sange mate, sange mate, dona prahara ratra pahuni ekanta. Aho rakuma bai. Rakuma bai, Vithoba si sanga, Rakuma bai, Rakuma bai, Vithoba vastrapatra nahi khaya jevayasi vastrapatra nahi khaya jevayasi nace aharnisha nirlajjasa चौदा मनुष्य आहे ती माझे घरी ही चौदा मनुष्य आहे ती माझे घरी हिंडती दारोदारी दारोदारी अन्ना साथी दोन प्रहर रात पाहुनी एकांत दोन प्रहर रात पाहुनी एकांत बरा मार्ग तुम्ही बरा मार्ग तुम्ही उमजो नी सांगा उमजो नी सांगा बरा मार्ग तुम्ही उमजो नी सांगा नाम याची राजा नव्हे भली नव्हे भली नाम याची राजा नव्हे भली नव्हे भली नव्हे भली दोन प्रहर पाहुनी एकांत राजाई वृत्तांत सांगे माते सांगे माते दोन प्रहर रात्र पाहुनी एकांत दोन प्रहर रात्र पाहुनी एकांत I hope it the voice is reaching out.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Yes, now we go ahead.
Is there anything you would like to tell us about this poem?
What would Jerry say about this? I identify with the counseling in the women's center. I have worked in the women's center.
What I find interesting
is, it is like that.
That she's talking about, those 14, they have been reduced to mouths. But if you were to actually return them to human beings, you know, write this in equity as it were, then Mahatma's words is Namdev.
Sorry to interrupt. Your audio is not very clear. I think...
Is this better now?
Yeah. It's, I think now it's fine. Yeah, please.
Yeah. So I think, whenever I read this one or hear it, I think about what she talks about, those 14 mouths, you know. And if you write the synecdoche, if you take the part for the whole and make those mouths into human beings again, what you are talking about is serious poetry. Namdev's mouth has to be filled. He's not a mouth. Zanabai's mouth has to be filled. She's not a mouth. She's one of our greatest poets. You know, these are the people who are living in that house. And sometimes you wish you were a fly on the wall to be able to live in those houses and hear what the discussions were. Did they talk about poetry or did they talk about God? Did they talk music
or did they talk food also? Like, what's for lunch? Yeah. You know, when you look, you read Ranabai's poetry, you see very often she's talking, she's using metaphors of sweeping, zaadalotta kare jani. You know, she's talking about sweeping the house, washing the house. She's an abandoned little girl. Now, abandoned or consecrated, we don't know. The stories that Mahipati tells us can be passed in any number of ways. She comes to the, one version is she comes to the temple and she says, I'm home. Now you can leave. And I'm immediately cast back into the temple of in Jerusalem, where the Christ child is sitting. And, you know, his father thinks he's gone with the mother, and the mother thinks he's gone with the father. And they're both terrified because they realize that he's not with both of them. They rush back to the temple and he's talking to the priests and he's discussing theology. And they say, why have you done this to us? And he says, I'm in my father's house. Why would I not be about my father's business? So there are echoes in these poems, you know, that bring you back to your own texts and return you to these mm-hmm. other texts. And you begin to see that, you know, that these echoes are precious and they're beautiful. And there's something much larger here than just a poem or just a complaint or just a mouth to be fed. There's a world in each of those mouths. And of course, when you say world and mouths, then you're thinking Krishna and, you know, and the stolen butter. each of these is like an echo. So like you were saying, I often felt when I was reading them that you were sitting in an echoing chamber and truth was echoing all around you in different ways.
Yeah. There's one of the poets, I don't recall who, you know, who talks about killing her mother-in-law, killing the sister-in-law. And, you know, I was telling Neelaji that you find something very similar in Lal Ded, for instance.
Yeah.
So, yeah. You know, this kind of embodied knowledge that you were talking about, you know, embodied experience. So it's, and this kind of, in this poem, you see this very easy, like familiarity with Rukmini and sisterhood, a sisterhood, which Neelaji talks about in the sense of a women's center where you could pour out and, you know, your heart. You know, these resonances, it's interesting, but probably it's an academic point, you know, how do these resonances come about? Is it pilgrimage? Is it just a shared experience? What is it? You know?
I think it is much. I don't think it is about literary referencing, really. Right. It's about the fact that all of us share a common humanity. Mm-hmm. And in that common humanity, you know, I was just reading this morning St. Francis d'Assisi talking about his body as his brother and saying that it is a recalcitrant brother. It won't do what he wants it to do. He's asking it, you know, for a little more penance, a little more fasting, and it won't. It's like, it just wants food. Yeah, and then you're thinking, look, Razai, look at the people around you. They're not just mouths. Look at them, actually. And look at, like, I mean, you know, and then Jani wants freedom, you know. What freedom does she want? She wants the freedom to be with him alone all night long. And that can be read in so many beautiful and exciting ways. We should allow ourselves to read them in beautiful and exciting ways. For me, the resonances are not academic. The resonances are about the fact that, you know, there is this poor forked thing, this little animal with this consciousness of being a little more than an animal and a little less than a god, somewhere in between, that this consciousness produces a variety of states. But there's a similarity in that variety. And the challenge for the saint, the challenge for the poet, the ones that connect with us, Lalla or Andal or, you know, Catherine of Siena, or I've been reading a lot of these after this experience. And, you know, many of them say the most startling things that you would never imagine. You would never imagine that a saint could say, but they do. And they are unafraid. And I remember Neelaji talking to me about confidence, about the confidence with which they invoke God, the confidence with which they state you know, Nayandev says that his Marathi can take on Sanskrit.
Yeah.
Go figure.
Mm.
It's a wonderful confidence, and it's where does it come from? It comes, I think, from God. But where does the sorrow and the terror come from? I think it comes from God. And I think we are told, William Blake, joy and grief is woven fine, a clothing for the soul divine. You don't just get joy for your soul. It comes woven in with grief. You know, that's God. That's bhakti. Grief, joy, walk. Will you walk this path? It's, Tukaram says somewhere, you know, it's not for the faint-hearted. It's not for the faint-hearted. Back off if you think bhakti is going to be like a bed of roses. Just back off. So these are very brave women. When she is here and she's complaining, you must read it in terms of the greater bravery of being able to talk to God and complain. Nindastuti.
Neela ji,
you're muted, Neela.
Even her.
Neela, you're muted. Can someone send her a message? Neela ji, you're muted.
No, I think she's.
Can you unmute her?
Cat is disabled, so we cannot send any message. It seems.
Ah, okay. Neela,
am I okay now? Muted.
Yeah, you're fine now. Go for it.
Yeah.
We can't see you though.
So I can see myself.
Yeah, I can see you.
I was thinking Namdev Dasar and his poetry, which comes straight from his life. And this is what happens in case of Janabai or Rajai for that matter. And Raj and Namdev's mother, Gunai, they both finally go with Shantan Namdev. They go to Pandharpur. They are allowed the entry, not like the Mahar saints like Chokha or Manka. They can enter the temple. But then similar, I feel that, which comes straight from life. And I don't know what's it's poetry. Is it decorative? It's just trying to interpret life. It's trying to say something that we live. And it's really all these things, questions come to my mind. What is poetry? Is it beautifying your own experience? To come in one of his, that Chandan, the sandalwood tree doesn't say I have fragrance in me. There is fragrance that goes out. So, is life itself poetry? Should it be poetry? Should it be beautiful? All these questions come to my mind when I read the poetry of Rajai and Janabai especially. What is it? It's a middle class expression. It's a really of life. So like we did Baluta and we could see how much of suffering is there. You can't imagine the suffering. Is suffering poetry? Is it possible? You don't want suffering, but you want to. All these questions come to my mind when I read and sing these things. And Namdev especially comes to my mind very much. Namdev Dasar and Mallika. So we go ahead now
to the third poem that who is the third poet you would like to read for us today?
Neela ji, I think you should introduce Mukta Bai.
Mukta Bai. But that will be the end of our program, no? Mukta Bai is the title song.
Yeah.
Mukta Bai is fantastic. She is able to get out of that miserable situation and think about it little detached. She walks with God and she experiences the blissful state of samadhi. She is one such person, an intellectual, a person who is one with all her goals. So that is why, should I read Dungi Akashi then?
Go ahead.
मुंगी उडाली आकाशी तिने गिळीले सूर्यासी थोर नवलाव झाला वांझे पुत्र प्रसवला विंचू पाता अशी जाय शेष माथा वंदी पाय माशी व्याली धार झाली देखोनी Muktai Hasil. What else can you?
An ant flew into the sky. An ant flew into the sky. She swallowed the sun. That wasn't the only wonder. The baron gave birth to a son. The scorpion burrows into the underworld and Shesh touches his feet unto a fly. A hawk is born. Mukta Bai watches, laughs.
Should we sing this now? Then we will have a space for question answers also. Now here I have not sung it in the typical Raag Kalingda or Gauri. Because this is a very different experience. And to me, it going to the sky, you see clouds and you see the sun and all the other, so many suns are there in the sky, the millions of them. And that really widens your horizon to such an extent that the only Raag which can try to carry that mood could be either Malhar or Megh. I decided to sing it in Megh, which is a pentatonic, and it goes to the sky. I really enjoyed singing it in Raag Megh and no Malhar.
Mungi udali
akashi mungi udali mungi udali akashi mungi udali mungi udali akashi mungi udali tine girile suryasi tine girile suryasi mungi udali mungi udali akashi mungi udali akashi mungi udali tine girile suryasi mungi udali tine girile suryasi mungi udali akashi mungi udali thora navalav jhala thora navalav jhala vanje पुत्र प्रसवला थोर नवलाव झाला वांझे पुत्र प्रसवला विंचु पाताळाशी विंचु पाताळाशी जाय विंचु पाताळाशी जाय शेष माथा शेष माथा वंदी पाय शेष माथा वंदी पाय मुंगी उडाली माशी व्याली माशी व्याली घर झाली माशी व्याली घर झाली माशी व्याली घर झाली देखो नी देखो नी मुक्ताई हासली देखो सूर्यासी मुड़ाली तिने गिले सूर्यासी मुंगी उड़ाली मुंगी उड़ाली आकाशी आकाशी मुंगी उड़ाली आकाशी मुंगी उड़ाली आकाशी This experience is so beautiful, it's so different that you can't sing it in the same rag and the same tune like Kalinda, Gauri, whatever. It requires certain treatment. And this Mungi is a very strong person. Any strong person can achieve anything. I don't want to give any message here after. बहुत हो गया, इससे ज्यादा नहीं.
I think we are both happy to take any questions if there are any from the audience.
Yes.
Kavita would moderate.
Yes. If anyone, I have, you could ask questions in the chat box. You could also raise your hands and I could unmute you one by one so that everyone doesn't speak together. Are there any questions? While we wait for people to gather, I just had a couple of questions. I'll start with one. Why is it, you know, I read in your introduction that so Muktai is part of the canon. She has been canonized as one of the... So why Mukta and why not the others? You know, what is... So Jerry said one point that Jerry made about her, the cerebral side, and that's also part of the question I was asking earlier about stock motifs that circulate. Is Muktai's voice different because of the belonging to this community that is clued into the Nath Sampraday, and is there a philosophical kind of do you see a difference in these poets where some write in more familiar devotional terms and others draw from a more philosophical context? Or is that a true, stranger distinction to make?
Neela, would you like to take that? Or would you like me to try?
I would like to say about Mumbai that she's the youngest in the family and she's the only girl in the family. All others are... great. Nimruti, Jnandar, he's a great writer and his images and everything is fabulous. And yet he gets depressed because he could not get the Monji Bandhan by the priests. And Muktabai said, take it easy. Don't worry. Vishwa hota vanni sant mukhe bhave pani. She says, the whole world is on fire. Now you have to pour water on them. Why are you crying? Why?
I think we've... Neelaji, I think we've lost your audio.
And her video.
Shall I call her, maybe?
Yeah. Meanwhile, Jerry, would you like to, because you were speaking about Muktabai earlier.
Well, one very easy way to look at it is that Muktabai is a Brahmin and the rest are not. Yeah. But she's also a Brahmin, we must remember, who has had experience of being outcast because of the peculiar circumstances of the family. So I think she has an in-out relationship with this whole thing. Her world is a very strange and beautiful and bizarre world. I actually, of all of them, I think Soira and Mukta, Muktabai and Soirabai, you get familiar with them, your buddies. I would like to have had conversations with them. I'd like to know what they were like, what they talked about. You know, they're very interesting women. Tanupatra, obviously, as a sex worker, would have a very interesting life. But so little of what we have, I think we've taken all the Tanupatra that there was and translated it. Mm-hmm. Because so little is left. Because I think there is a slight squeamishness about the fact that she is a sex worker. But Muktabai is there are two sides to her. One is that conversation with Sokhameda. So she's having this really intense philosophical dialogue and debate with him. And on the other hand, there is that family of four. Sopanandev, Vruttinath, Maneshwar. She's living with all of them. I mean, you know, it doesn't get more startlingly, I don't know. I think there must have been, again, I think Neelaji talks about confidence, you know, the ability to know where you are, to know that this is your, I think you talk about the Nath Sampradaya, there is that family Sampradaya, you know, that it just seems to be like really, really amazing. I don't think there's anything like it. Where are there four poets? Yeah. In one family. So Muktabai, I think, is for that reason. And of course, there's Tati Ugad. Tati Ugad, when she tells her brother, open those blasted windows, connect. She's saying what Foster said later, only connect. Connect with the world. You've got to face this. That's irresistible. That, you know, at one level she can be talking high philosophy, and at another level she can be saying, "This is it. This is what we've got to be doing. Mm-hmm. You and I, we've got to be actually doing this. You can't lock yourself away. There is no ivory tower. Mm-hmm. It's up to us. And this actually is revolutionary." Actually, it's revolutionary because there is no go tell it on the mountain in classical Hinduism, you know, in the way that Christianity talks about witness and going out and spreading the word and whatnot. There is another economy of information that is at work in classical Hinduism, which bhakti is disrupting. It's pushing its way through that Upanishad, you know, come sit next to me and let me tell you a few truths about the world. Bhakti is shouting. And Muktabai is telling him, shout. It's lovely. I think that's why she's so,
I think, Neelaji, are you back? Can you hear us?
Yeah, I'm there.
Yeah, so you were saying something before.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
You were saying something when we lost your audio. We were talking about...
I agree with Jerry. Mm. I agree with Jerry fully that she is like a revolutionary. You have to face the world. Don't shut yourself in. Whatever it is, take it. Face it.
Okay. I think there was a question earlier from Meeta Joshi, but I can't see her anywhere here anymore.
If the question is good, we'll answer it. Your recording, she can hear it later.
So there's a question in the chat box, so which I want to come to now, because I also had a related question for you, Jerry. The question by Anita in the chat box is, what is the challenge in being a translator true to a work or poet in your experience? And to this, I want to add a question, which is, you know, because it's not just translating. Okay, I want to cancel the word just, but when you translate, and when you translate something that is sacred, you know, is there a difference?
Okay, so first, let's just talk about sacred for a moment, huh? Because it is a word that is of great interest. Okay, what does sacred mean? It means referring to God, right? Yeah. Now, if it refers to God and then there is the sacred, what is the opposite of the sacred? There is the profane. What is the profane? The profane is the worldly. Where does the belch fit in? Where does the belch fit in? Is it sacred or is it profane? Now, our ladies, these bhakti poets, don't see this difference. They don't see the difference between the sacred and the profane. We come to them sort of bowed and bent and whatnot. They are looking us in the eye and they're saying, you know, God, he belched over me. I fed him. He came hungry and I fed him. And then he belched. That's confidence. There is no sacred, there is no profane. We'll spend the night together. Kill my mother-in-law. You know? It's just, they are so, so clear about the universality of experience. The fact that everything is God. Everything, including if Jerry Pinto does a bad translation, that's also part of it. It's okay. Whenever I felt like, I mean, you know, like I felt, what damage are you doing, Jerry? Because, okay, let's just take Mungi Udali Akash. There is one moment when she talks, she says Vintu. She talks about the scorpion. What is the scorpion? The scorpion is lust. The scorpion is in Sanskrit aesthetics, is lust. Right? When you go to Khajuraho and if you see a woman with a scorpion on her thigh, you know she's in a state of high passion. That is where we get bichhu lad gaya re mujhe bichhu lad gaya. Sare badan mein zeher chad gaya. Like that kind of passion that you know it's running through me. It's inflaming me. That's passion. Now when I say scorpion, what comes through? A Mahindra Jeep in English? What comes through? Nothing. Night of the Scorpion by Nisim Ezekiel. This does not come through. So each time you think I'm doing damage, each time you think, forgive me, each time the saints laugh, they say, we knew you were coming. We knew this damage. We knew this. Don't worry. Go on. Go on. This thing, you know, if you look at the introduction that Neela wrote, and which I translated, there is a moment where he says, a beautiful idea that, you know, I'm water. The tiger will come to drink. Yeah, and the cow will come to drink. I'm still water. You just wish everybody could be like that. It would make things so much easier if we could just stay water. We can't. We find it very difficult to stay water. That they could. That they tried. That they often were and often failed. Okay? That is what connects, what you can reach out across those centuries. You can reach out across traditions. You can reach out across languages and you can receive the sacred and the profane and you can belch your satisfaction because God belched. God belched. And if God can belch, Jerry can belch. We are free. See bhakti as freeing. I kept telling myself and then fear would come back. Error would come back. Am I getting this wrong? Is this what she means? Is this what it is? Is this? You know? But the path is very difficult, but it is such fun. Such fun to be doing this. And I have to thank Neela ji for leading me down this
path. There were some issues about how to translate Jerry, that Savale Dorasa Karuna Yeo De Kahi. That Dorasa was such a difficult thing to translate. And you really did very well, I thought.
Yeah, yeah. We went through endless, and you know, Neela would sit there looking compassionate. and you know, like a student, I would be sitting on the mat in front of her, and I would read it out and hope that it was working this time. And she'd look and she'd smile and then she'd say, "Okay, let it be then." And I said, "No, it's not working then, right? I mean, if you're saying let it be then." Then finally came to what it was, you know, what it should be. And that is the moment when everyone just settled down. It's actually like sometimes things just fell into place. And sometimes you felt you were carrying a huge stone somewhere. And you were going nowhere with that stone.
Mm. Now that poem you talk about, you know, it has some of the most startling imagery, like even in the translation. You know, I think the Marathi is Devane Dakar Dili or something, but in the English you translate it as God belched all over her or something like that.
Yeah.
So again,
God belched his love over me.
Yes. Yes. But so that entire, it sets off many, many connotations. Yeah.
I think you could read the whole Bible and you wouldn't find a belch. But this is the thing. Yeah. When you go, I approach these with great respect, great trepidation, and great fear. And I was met with laughter. They laugh. But they said, that's not the way you're supposed to come. You're supposed to come naked and unafraid. You're supposed to come and experience this with us. See if you can. Even a trace of it. If you get a trace of it, it'll be all right. Trace. See, at the end of the day, a bhakti poem is a trace. It's the state is what you're seeking. You're seeking to be God mad dancing in the street. Right? And you are writing God mad dancing in the street. Those words may be beautiful, may be meaningful, may be rhythmic, may be everything. But they are not the state. They are what's left behind of the state. They're a hint, a clue, a thread. We hold the thread and then if we are courageous, we enter the labyrinth and we are led somewhere. So we, you know, often we mistake scripture for state. You know, scripture is trace. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. So beautiful. You said it. You don't want. You stopped wanting. Really? How cool that would be if the trace became the state. But it doesn't. So really, 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 at the end of the day, you know, the bhakti, the poets reassured. These women reassured. They said, you do what you have to do. You do what you have to do. It's all karma, no? Neela will do. Other translators will come and do. We may also be completely erased and forgotten. Don't worry. I would hate it if they were erased and forgotten because it would be tragic. It would be part of our patriarchal society that forgets women's work. All that, yes. But the women are really terribly concerned. I don't think. You know? I don't think. You know, Neela ji talks about Tsokha Mela not saying Johar, my Bab Johar. Mahar. You know? Tsokha Mela is not worth it. That's what they think I sang. Go ahead. I think that's what saints... what is that saint state? No? Centrally, I think it is the ability to look at the rest of humanity gently.
to look at all of us gently and then to warn us. It's not going to be easy. You're struggling. Oh, so much. It's struggle. It's forest fire. It's drowning. The roof flying off your... so many warnings. But you might want to come here. There will be days when we are dancing and clapping and touching each other's feet and just that it's we're in the flow. And there are days when in the second watch of the night, you'll wake up hungry. And you'll wonder how you're going to feed everybody tomorrow.
This also reminds me of Rabindranath Tagore's Je Rate Mor Duar Boli Bhanglo Ghare Jani Nai To Tumi Ele Amar Ghare. Like that.
Shali, there's another question in the chat box. Professor Kanchana Mahadevan, can you unmute yourself? You could ask.
Hi, Kanchana.
Yeah. Hi, Jerry.
Hi. How are you?
I'm good. How are you? It has been extremely illuminating listening to you and Neela and Kavita's conversation today. And I'm very, very grateful for this because I think you're opening up a whole new domain in Indian philosophy. And it's very, very exciting that this domain has opened up a democratic space, you know, where learning is possible for everybody without caste and gender and patriarchy and all of that. So I was just eager to know about Bhakti's relationship to labor, because most of the imagery I found also to have some amount of striving, laboring, and what Kavita earlier said, embodiment, you know. So can one say that the divine is accessible via labor rather than just through some kind of intellectual darshana, as they put it, you know, the Upanishadic darshana. Somebody has a great esoteric vision, and that is a vision that is unique to that person because that person is born in a particular caste and so forth. And then the Shishya, like Ekalavya, you know, has to go and plead, you know, for that kind of knowledge, which may come or may not. But against that is Bhakti advocating, it seemed to me, listening to both of you, that if one labors, one does, one can, let us say, get a glimpse, as you say, that Derridean beautiful word that you use, a trace of divinity.
Neelaji, would you like to take that as an answer?
I would refer to Janabai in this case, because Janabai was an orphan. I mean, there are theories which try to say that no, she belonged to a tailor's caste, but she did not. She was given away by her parents because they could not afford to look after her. They gave, and then the father said, oh, I dreamt that my daughter should be there in your family and should do well. So the father gives the daughter when she was just 6 years old. And since then, now look at this, Namdev was a saint, but Janabai was a dasi. She was a maid. And probably she was also a low caste person because she was not allowed entry in the Pandharpur temple. So that is likely to be true if you read her abhans. And she loved Vithala because she needed to somehow bear with the cleaning the garbage, cleaning the courtyard, go and collect cow dung and do the, you know, do the work with the car. All that she must be fed up. What can a 6-year-old and 7-year-old do? Now, somebody must have helped her. There are good people in the world. Even in those days, they must have been helped. And they helped. And that was like, her goal was reaching Vithala, like Namdev and all the other saints who used to come to Namdev's house. So, Vithala came and he helped me. She's grinding. Oh, Vithala came and helped me. She's sleeping alone. Vithala comes and sleeps next to her and leaves her har, Ratna har over there. And then people want to kill her. Then Vithala comes and somehow saves her. There are nice people who save a person, an orphan. It's not an orphanage, but it is like after comes out. And that nest survives. It's there, it was there, and it's today there. It's all in spite of the COVID, we are all managing our values and work and missions. So that's what it is. Someone will help you. That's, I don't know if it is divine, it is very human. I'm a humanist.
Thank you. I think there is there's one more question.
I think Shruti Vishwanath is here. She also sings. Jerry, you probably Jerry and Nilata, you probably know her.
Yeah, she sings.
She had a question. She had a comment. Maybe
voice is very strong.
Yeah. Hi, Jerry. Hi, Nila ji. Lovely to see you. First of all, congratulations. This is beautiful work. I was just wondering. I mean, there's lots to share, but I'll kind of keep it to a question. I wanted to ask you how you translate, especially Dalit voices from all these years ago, and voices that are so close to the ground with so much realness. How do you find English for that? Because that as somebody who also works a little bit on all of this, it's something I've always had questions about, and I find it problematic in my own work as well, just because English is such a restricting language in some of these cases. So how did you go about finding language for that?
To begin with, you know, I think when I was growing up, it was made very clear to me again and again that English was not a language of success. Teachers would tell you routinely that if you only knew English, you were bound to be a failure in life. You had to learn other languages. Okay, this is an interesting thing, because right now it seems that the whole narrative has shifted again to English is the passport to success. So I remember living in a world in which, I'm a minority after 92, I remember the first time it was in 92, in December 92, when someone said to me, you're a minority, you know. It's like a little surprise. I thought, I always thought I was a minority of one. Everybody's a minority of one, because that's how we are. And here there was someone saying that you're a minority. And English was my language. So a disempowered person, a minority person with disempowered, has a disempowered language, whatever language you speak. You know, if you are cast in a certain role, whatever language you speak will be a disempowered language. So if a Dalit chooses to write in Marathi and chooses to write in Brahminical Punekari Saraswat Marathi, it will still be a disempowered language. So let's not conflate and confuse easily the language and the status that language may occupy. Then, you know, whenever this conversation comes up, I beg to inform everyone that English is a Devi. There is an English Devi somewhere in North India, who is a Dalit goddess, because she offers the possibility of success. It is to that Dalit Devi, English, that I brought these humble offerings of poetry. You will say this is a very slimy, slimy thing to do. Okay, that you're, that now you are conflating a large number of things and you're getting out of it. But there's no real easy answer. There's no answer. Into what language would you take these? Into what language?
Hello, Jerry. I think we've lost his
audio. Gone.
Okay, we'll wait for him to join back. Meanwhile, Neelaji, there are a couple of comments in the chat box. There is Anita. Anita, would you like to unmute yourself and ask the question you'd ask me?
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much, Neelaji and Jerry, for this lovely evening of this poetry renditions. I just had a point that I think, you know, one of the key things that we constantly, when we are reading about women saints or women bhakti poets of India, I think they just created such a simplified and musical method for anybody to reach that stage or reach that point. Neelaji, as you mentioned, for Janabai, she just dissolved in Vithala, you know, after all those things that kept happening to her and everything. And I just feel that they just had a way to simplify the scriptures and texts that were probably not available to everyone in those times. You know, that's what the OVs talk about. That's what the Abhangs also talk about. And I, you know, that was just a little point that I wanted to add. And probably, you know, the caste system really didn't play into their into their fold as such, because they just took it as a point wherein, you know, this is the way I can reach him. I don't need to be a part of the mainstream, mainstream culture or anything. This is my way of just reaching him, and I'm going to do it. So that's what I wanted to share. And thank you so much. Or probably, please correct me if there's something more to add. Thank you.
I would like to say in this that it was Janeshwar who created fantastic, beautiful language in which he tried to reach out the message of being able to reach your goal in spite of being in any caste, born in any caste, it doesn't matter. That's why Janeshwar is considered to be a leader of the group. And Janabai says, Viveka Sagara Sakham Asad Janeshwar. She doesn't stop there. She says, Maroniya Jave, Majha Chiva Pota Yave. I would like to have a child like Janeshwar. She really loves him. And I think all these other saints come up because they were inspired by Janeshwar. And that is where Muktabai said, don't worry. Why are you worried about the people? They are going to say whatever they want. But Vishwa Hota Vani Santa Mukhe Bhave Pani. You have to teach them. You have to uplift them. You have to show them what the real craving is for. I must also mention Professor Sardar, who was a Marxist, and he made a Marxist analysis of the saints' work. On the one hand, he says that they tried to democratize bhakti in society. But on the other hand, he also has a criticism that they gave inspiration to people from all castes just to, you know, go on clapping and go ahead with your bhakti, vithala, vithala, vithala. They are called talkute. The talkuta is someone who is just clapping and going ahead and not worried about the reality, the social reality, the goals in life, the life itself. What I personally felt when I really read, this was all the analysis which we read for BA and MA, and we have to quote what Sardar said. And I did that. But now when I really read the bhakti poetry, I feel, oh, they had a lot to give to people. They really uplifted so many people. You go to Arandi and see the place there. There are many people sitting and reading Jnaneshwari there. They, do they understand? I don't know, but they read and they read and they are there. Even in Dehu, the Tukaram's place, there they want to read Tukaram. Tukaram is much easier to understand than Jnaneshwar. Jnaneshwar is very poetic. He's fantastic. He's so beautiful poetry he writes. And examples and analogies that he gives, beautiful.
I'm sorry, my phone gave out there and I have like Samsung Deva just interrupted my show, but I'm back now. But I think it is kind of time for us to kind of wind up, no?
Yeah, it is. Can we take a couple of more questions?
Yes, I think there are a couple more.
There are a few in the chat box and there's been a hand raised for some time. Can I request Mr. Santosh Kumar to ask his question? Please unmute yourself. You're still here. Okay, there's also, while we wait for him, there was an interesting discussion in the chat box about, you know, this idea of labor and laboring with God. You know, the butcher, the farmer, that is also an idea that is found in the Upanishads. And Professor Kanchana Mahadevan is asking the question, you know, maybe the very act of laboring is sacred. You know, is that's the question. And it reminds me of that Janabai's poem where she is, you know, Vittala is the companion and comrade who is laboring with her. So how would you, Neelaji or Jerry?
You know, for me, I think the obvious thing is you look at to go back to the Bible for a moment, there are any number of parables that Christ uses to talk about which all talk about labor. You know, the sower of the seed, the man hiring laborers for his vineyard, the many are called but few are chosen. There's just like loads and loads and loads, you fishers of men. It's just like everywhere. The understanding, I think, is that labor is fundamental to human dignity also at a certain level. So what labor you do obviously sometimes gets stratified, and some labor is given more dignity than other labor, right? So then the bhakti poet has to come along and perhaps remind you that there is beauty in the labor, in the labor that is done. In my own practice, I think, for instance, one of the things that we did in the social communications media department at SCM is, every year, we take our students and make them plant rice. They go and they plant rice for a whole day. And this has two effects. One is a great respect for those wiry women who all day will be planting rice with their backs bent, but will be singing, still singing. Okay? And second, they stop wasting food because they see the labor that goes into food. Now, labor, when it is embodied in this way, when it becomes part of, I think there was another experiment with college students in America, where they were made to carry all the water that they would need up to their dormitories to the, you know, the fourth floor on their backs, just to see how much effort it takes to actually just carry water, you know, and you take it for granted because you're opening a tap and the water is flowing. So I think when we talk about labor, the body, which is very, very precious to the to the bhakti poets, because it is so ignored by the more spiritual people, who see the body as kind of like their enemy, as the thing that's standing in the way, because the sukshma sharir is so much better, whatever they want to say, you know, that it's just like a barrier between yourself and understanding. For the bhakti poet,
it's an understanding that this is the means, this is the sadhan, this is how you're going to get it. And when you're singing bhakti, then your throat knows bhakti, and your voice knows bhakti, and your ears know bhakti. Everything knows bhakti in a way that your lungs know bhakti. In a way that when you're reading, it's not going to happen. Yeah? Is there another question?
And another thing which Gnaneshwar has put in very beautifully, he says that when you devote yourself through your labor to whatever achievement you have in mind, that itself uplifts everything. Because he says the ego comes in, and here when you devote, there is no ego. Manoni Deepa Palave, he says, Savechi Teja Malave. When you extinguish the light of the lamp, the light is going and the ego goes away through your labor.
The danger of this only is in what happened with, say, Gandhi, when he talked in his early years, when he talks to Bhangis and he tells them that when you're cleaning night soil, clean night soil with devotion and with love. You clean it with great love. You must love the people whose shit you're cleaning, and you must treat them with love. That's difficult. Then this is it. Actually, embodiment and labor, when it actually becomes about shit and piss, right? Then our thoughts turn a little differently. So we can talk about applying bhakti to everything. But in our middle class experience, we are not talking about cleaning the toilet. Again, at SCM, social communications media, I often say, have you met a dirty toilet? And everybody says yes. And I say, did you clean the toilet? Or did you leave it dirtier? What was your role in that dirty toilet? And sometimes if a student has that kind of spirit, he or she will say, that's why I pay my taxes, so that I can have clean toilets. Is it? Really? How much of your taxes?
I have a point to make here.
So I'm saying everything that you have to use, everything that comes along, comes down this road. You have to turn into the body. Turn it to the body. You don't turn it into the mind. You don't leave it in the mind. Take it down there into the body. And then say, can I say this about cleaning a toilet? If I can, then this works. If I cannot, then I need again to be thinking about this again, to be working with this, to be negotiating with this. What is labor? What do I mean by labor? What does Jani mean by labor? Because she probably went out clean. She probably had to clean the baby's bumps. You know? So the idea of with bhakti do your work, we are talking to, as the middle class, to the middle class. Be a student. Do your dharma. Study hard. Read Revolution by Baburao Bagul. I've translated it into Marathi, so it's easier if you want. Revolt is a story by Baburao Bagul. It is a terrifying story. Terrifying. It's a young man who will not eat his mother's food. His mother cooks, but he will not touch it, because she touches shit. That is also our reality. And we must not flinch from that reality. Bhakti requires us to accept all this as reality. And now, I really have to be going. It was wonderful talking to all of you. And I'm sure Neelaji will be answering questions. But I have another appointment. Thank you very much, Sumaya. Thank you, Dharma Studies.
for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, Jerry. Thank you so much. It was wonderful. And hope to see you again soon. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So, Neelaji, you were saying something. Yeah.
I was saying something that most of the roles in a society, like the role of a cleaner, what about a woman who does all these roles? I clean my toilet. I clean it very nicely. I don't like the shit lying around in the pot. I clean it. I don't think it's slowly. I need a clean toilet, so I have to do it. And all these jobs are, in a way, they have an equal status. That's what Gandhi meant. Don't put the hierarchy in the, apply the hierarchy in the context of labor. All labor is equal. And that equality is what the bhakti poets try to give you, the sense of equality.
Yes.
I think, at least personally, I feel that most of the women do that, and also men do it. And I remember the example of this ballet dancer, Vaclav Nijinsky. Mm-hmm. He was a great dancer. And when he married Romula and they had a baby, he was doing everything for the baby. He didn't treat himself as a man. Oh, I'm not going to do it. My wife will. He did everything. So that is the kind of treating each job as equally valuable job. And that, I think, is very necessary. We have created the hierarchy through the knowledge of Sanskrit. Those who know Sanskrit are higher in status. So therefore, that's how Brahmins became great. But what about Tukaram, who didn't know Sanskrit? He was a great man also. And what about Jani, who was an orphan and had nothing in her hands? But she was a great woman, so strong, and she did achieve what she wanted to. That's what I mean by Mungi Udali Akashi. You can achieve anything. This is what I learned from the women's saints poetry. And also, I think it's very much applicable in the Gandhian explanations of labor, work, any work. And there were many Gandhians in the pre-independence era when writers like Mate, he used to sweep the roads, because who will clean it otherwise? Why should only a sweeper should do it? I'll also do it. There was a movement like that of doing everything yourself. Vinoba Bhave did that in his ashram in Kauna. So there is a limit to it. I know. My legs are aching. I cannot do it. Oh, I still have to do it. Okay, I'll try. But if someone else do it, fine. I will feel that. But there is equal status to all kinds of labor in the saint poetry. That is what is de-Brahminizing the message of Gita. Everyone has written on Gita, but you have to derive a different message for people, common people, people from all castes, all economic layers, and everywhere. They are equal people.
Someone in the chat box, in fact, mentioned Karma Yoga. You know, so what you are saying about deriving a different message from the Gita, a different message about dignity and labor and true equality. So thank you so much, Neelaji. We have kept you half an hour beyond time. This was a fabulous session. I'm sure all of us, I'm very eager to listen to Janabai and many of the other poets, but I think we will attend. You will be having more sessions of the book at other places. And I'm sure all of us attend those sessions and listen to both you and Jerry. It was absolutely wonderful. So thank you, not just for this session, but for this book. I hope all of you go and buy it. I hope you can see it. It's the book that has been translated by Neelaji and Jerry. Yeah. And Terry Pinto.
This awesome.
Yeah. So thank you so much for this wonderful discussion. Thank you to all the participants today. And most of all to Professor Vidya Venkateshan, who has enabled this evening by putting us in, telling us about the book and putting us in touch with both Neelaji and Jerry Pinto. We look forward to many such conversations with all of you. And, you know, at the Institute of Dharma Studies, Neelaji, we look forward to more conversations with you on bhakti, you know, and we are looking forward. Neelaji mentioned that she's working further on Janabai. Each one of these poets is, yeah, go ahead, Neelaji.
Also, there are the bhakti and Sufi meet. There is a meeting of both in the classical music. Yeah. Which is not understood very properly in the field of music. It still gets Brahmanized. Bhakti, Sufi, they come together and trying to see the creation of the world, how every equal may be. Some are small, some are big, but they are all equal. That's what Allah says and that's what Ishwar says. That is the togetherness in classical music. So all our culture, I think, is giving us a fantastic message which we understand and put into practice. That's, and I'm really happy you're doing all of that, because that's the real Indianness. I feel that there is oneness, there is no hierarchy. There is love for one another, and all that is there in our arts. Music is really beautiful in that. So deep it is. Classical music is very deep. We only look for the fast speed of the tans, but there is such a lot more in classical music. Beautiful. So I would be happy to meet you again, and thank you so much for all that. Half an hour more is not much. It's okay.
Very gracious of you. And we also look forward to this one evening of Bhakti and Sufi.
That will be wonderful.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay, bye.
Bye. And we'll be in touch. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.